This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Allied Victory Armistice of Mudros Collapse of the Ottoman Empire Foundation of New States in the Middle East Treaty of Brest-Litovsk, Treaty of Batum, Treaty of Sevres Territorial Changes Partitioning of the Ottoman Empire Belligerents. Armenian Volunteers France French Armenian Legion French West Africa French Equatorial Africa Armenia 1918. 2,550,000 to 1,000,000, several hundred thousand, 70,000 total, 3,620,000 to 2,800,000 total conscripted, max size 800,000 at some time, 2,100,000 August 1916, 20,000 total 1,918 to 9,000 1918 total Ottoman army was 323,000 on the day of the armistice of Mudros total of 2,002,000 soldiers on all fronts casualties and losses 1 million to 1,500,000 killed, wounded, captured or missing 1,500,000 killed, wounded, captured or missing including 243,598 combat dead total 5 million including civilians. The breakdown of Ottoman casualties is listed under Ottoman Casualties of World War I VE Theaters of World War I European Balkans Western Front Eastern Front Italian Front Middle Eastern Caucasus Persia Gallipoli Mesopotamia Sinai and Palestine Arab Revolt South Arabia African Southwest Africa Togoland Cameroon East Africa North Africa Asian and Pacific Theater Naval Theaters U-Boat Atlantic Ocean Mediterranean The Middle Eastern Theater of World War I saw action between 29 October 1914 and 30 October 1918 The combatants were, on one side, the Ottoman Empire including Kurds and some Arab tribes, with some assistance from the other Central Powers, and on the other side, the British with the help of Jews, Greeks, Assyrians and the majority of the Arabs, the Russians with the help of Armenians and the French from the Allies of World War I. There were five main campaigns, the Sinai and Palestine Campaign, the Mesopotamian Campaign, the Caucasus Campaign, the Persian Campaign, and the Gallipoli Campaign. There were also several minor campaigns, the North African Campaign, Arab Campaign, and South Arabia Campaign. Both sides used local asymmetrical forces in the region. On the Allied side were Arabs who participated in the Arab Revolt and the Armenian militia who participated in the Armenian resistance during the Armenian Genocide, along with Armenian volunteer units. The Armenian militia formed the Armenian Corps of the First Republic of Armenia in 1918. In addition, the Assyrians joined the Allies following the Assyrian Genocide, instigating the Assyrian War of Independence. The Turkish Ottomans had the support of Kurds, Turkomans, Circassians, Chechens and a number of Iranian, Arab and Berber groups. The theater covered the largest territory of all theaters in the war. Russian participation in the theater ended as a result of the armistice of Erzincan 5 December 1917, after which the revolutionary Russian government withdrew from the war under the terms of the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk. 3 March 1918 The Armenians attended the Trabzon Peace Conference 14 March 1918 which resulted in the Treaty of Batum on 4 June 1918. The Ottomans accepted the armistice of Mudros with the Allies on 30 October 1918, and signed the Treaty of Sevres on 10 August 1920 and later the Treaty of Lausanne on 24 July 1923 Contents 1 Objectives 11 Ottomans and Central Powers 12 Allies 13 Armenians 2 Operational Area 3 Ottomans on the Eastern European Front 4 Forces 41 Central Powers Ottoman Empire 411 Recruitment 42 Entente Nations 421 Recruitment 43 Asymmetrical Forces 5 Chronology 51 Prelude 5-2-1914 5-2-1 November 522 December 5-3-1915 5-3-1 January to March 532 April to June 533 July to September 534 October to December 54-1916 55-1917 56-1918 6 Aftermath 61 Military Occupation 62 Peace Treaty 63 Abolition of the Caliphate 7 Casualties 8 Timeline 9 See also 10 Footnotes 11 Bibliography 12 Further Reading 13 External Links Objectives Ottomans and Central Powers The Ottoman Empire joined the Central Powers through the secret Ottoman-German alliance. which was signed on 2 August 1914. The main objective of the Ottoman Empire in the Caucasus was the recovery of its territories that had been lost during the Russo-Turkish War, 1877-78, in particular Artvin, Ardahan, Kars, and the port of Batum. Success in this region would force the Russians to divert troops from the Polish and Galician fronts. German advisors with the Ottoman armies supported the campaign for this reason from an economic perspective. The Ottoman, or rather German, strategic goal was to cut off Russian access to the hydrocarbon resources around the Caspian Sea. Germany established an intelligence bureau for the East on the eve of World War I. The bureau was involved in intelligence gathering and subversive missions to Persia and Egypt, and to Afghanistan, to dismantle the Anglo-Russian Entente. Ottoman War Minister Enver Pasha claimed that if the Russians could be beaten in the key cities of Persia, it could open the way to Azerbaijan, as well as the rest of the Middle East and the Caucasus if these nations were to be removed from Western influence. Enver envisioned a cooperation between these newly established Turkic states. Enver's project conflicted with European interests, which played out as struggles between several key imperial powers. The Ottomans also threatened Britain's communications with India and the East via the Suez Canal. Allies, the British feared that the Ottomans might attack and capture the Middle East and later Caspian oil fields. The British Royal Navy depended upon oil from the petroleum deposits in southern Persia, to which the British-controlled Anglo-Persian Oil Company had exclusive access. The Russians viewed the Caucasus front as secondary to the Eastern Front. They feared a campaign into the Caucasus aimed at retaking Kars, which had been taken from the Ottoman Empire during the Russo-Turkish War 1877-1878, and the port of Batum in March 1915, when the Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Sazonov met with British Ambassador George Buchanan and French Ambassador Maurice Palaiologue. He stated that a lasting post-war settlement demanded full Russian possession of the capital city of the Ottoman Empire, Constantinople, the Straits of the Bosphorus and Dardanelles, the Sea of Marmara, southern Thrace up to the Enos-Midia line, as well as parts of the Black Sea coast of Anatolia between the Bosphorus, the Sakarya River and an undetermined point near the Bay of Izmit. The Russian imperial government planned to replace the Muslim population of northern Anatolia and Istanbul with more reliable Cossack settlers. Armenians. The Armenian National Liberation Movement sought to establish an Armenian state within the Armenian Highlands. The Armenian Revolutionary Federation achieved this goal later in the war, with the establishment of the internationally recognized First Republic of Armenia in May 1918. As early as 1915, the administration for Western Armenia and later Republic of Mountainous Armenia were Armenian-controlled entities, while the Centro-Caspian dictatorship was established with Armenian participation. None of these entities were long-lasting operational area. See also, Caucasus Campaign, Sinai and Palestine Campaign, Gallipoli Campaign, Mesopotamian Campaign, Persian Campaign, and Arab Revolt. The Caucasus Campaign comprised armed conflicts between the Ottoman Empire and the Allies, the forces of the latter including Azerbaijan, Armenia, Central Caspian Dictatorship, and the UK as part of the Middle Eastern Theatre, or alternatively named, as part of the Caucasus Campaign. During World War I, the Caucasus Campaign extended from the Caucasus to Eastern Asia Minor, reaching as far as Trabzon, Bitlis, Mush and Van. The warfare on land was accompanied by actions undertaken by the Russian Navy in the Black Sea region of the Ottoman Empire. On 23 February 1917, the Russian advance was halted following the Russian Revolution, and later the disintegrated Russian Caucasus Army was replaced by the forces of the newly established Armenian state, which comprised the previous Armenian volunteer units and the Armenian irregular units. During 1918, the region also saw the establishment of the Central Caspian Dictatorship, the Republic of Mountainous Armenia, and an allied force named Dunster Force, which was composed of elite troops drawn from the Mesopotamian and Western fronts. The Ottoman Empire and German Empire fought each other at Batumi after the arrival of the German Caucasus expedition, whose prime aim was to secure oil supplies. On 3 March 1918, the conflict between the Ottoman Empire and Russia ended with the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk, and on 4 June 1918, the Ottoman Empire signed the Treaty of Batum with Armenia. However, the armed conflicts extended as the Ottoman Empire continued to engage with the Central Caspian Dictatorship, Republic of Mountainous Armenia, and British Empire Empire forces from Dunsterfors until the Armistice of Mudros was signed on 30 October 1918. Top, destruction in the city of Erzurum, left upper, Russian forces, left lower, wounded Muslim refugees, right upper, Ottoman forces, right lower, Armenian refugees. The Gallipoli Campaign, February-April 1915. Top, the size of the stars show where the active conflicts occurred in 1915, left upper, Armenians defending the walls of Van in the spring of 1915, left lower, Armenian resistance in Urfa, right, a 70-year-old Armenian priest leading Armenians to battlefield Ottomans on the Eastern European front. See also, Balkans Campaign, World War I and Romania. During World War I, over 90,000 Ottoman troops were sent to the Eastern European front in 1916, to participate in operations in Romania. In the Balkans Campaign, the Central Powers asked for these units to support their operations against the Russian army later. It was concluded that the deployment was a mistake, as these forces would have been better placed remaining to protect Ottoman territory against the massive Erzurum offensive that the Russian army had begun. The relocation of troops to the Eastern European front was initiated by Enver. It was originally rejected by the German Chief of Staff, Erich von Falkenhayn, but his successor, Paul von Hindenburg, agreed to it, albeit with reservations. The decision was reached after the Brusilov offensive, as the Central Powers were running short of men on the Eastern Front. In the deployment, Enver sent the 15th Army Corps to Galicia, the 6th Army Corps to Romania, and the 20th Army Corps and 177th Infantry Regiment to Macedonia in early 1916. There are two Turkish sources regarding these operations, and respectively they state 117,000 and 130,000 men were sent, but both agree that nearly 8,000 of them were killed in action, with another 22,000 being wounded. Forces see also, list of commanders in the Middle Eastern theater of World War I. Central Powers, Ottoman Empire War Minister Ismail Enver. Of the Ottoman Empire, Austrian troops marching up Mount Zion in Jerusalem, 1916, after the Young Turk Revolution and the establishment of the Second Constitutional Era. Turkish, İkinci Mesrutiyet Devri. On 3 July 1908, a major military reform started. Army headquarters were modernized. The Ottoman Empire was engaged in the Turco-Italian War and Balkan Wars, which forced more restructuring of the army. Only a few years before the First World War, during this period, the empire divided its forces into armies. Each army headquarters consisted of a chief of staff, an operations section, intelligence section, logistics section, and a personnel section. As a long-established tradition in the Ottoman military, supply, medical and veterinary services were included in these armies in 1914. Before the empire entered the war, the four armies divided their forces into corps and divisions, such that each division had three infantry regiments and an artillery regiment. The main units were, 1st Army with 15 divisions, 2nd Army with 4 divisions plus an independent infantry division with 3 infantry regiments and an artillery brigade, 3rd Army with 9 divisions, 4 independent infantry regiments and 4 independent cavalry regiments, tribal units, and the 4th Army with 4 divisions. In August 1914, of 36 infantry divisions organized, 14 were established from scratch and were essentially new divisions in a very short time. 8 of these newly recruited divisions went through major redeployment during the war. More armies were established, 5th Army and 6th Army in 1915, 7th Army and 8th Army in 1917, and Kuvayi İnzibatiye, citation needed, and the Army of Islam, which had only a single corps. In 1918, by 1918, the original armies had been so badly reduced that the empire was forced to establish new unit definitions which incorporated these armies. These were the Eastern Army Group and Yildirim Army Group. However, although the number of armies was increasing over the 4 years of the war, the empire's resources of manpower and supplies were declining, so that the army groups in 1918 were smaller than the armies of 1914. The Ottoman army was still partially effective until the end of the war. Most military equipment was manufactured in Germany or Austria, and maintained by German and Austrian engineers. Germany also supplied most of the military advisors. A force of specialist troops, the Asia Corps, was dispatched in 1917, and increased to a fighting force of 2 regiments in 1918. The German Caucasus Expedition was established in the formerly Russian Transcaucasia around early 1918. During the Caucasus Campaign, its prime aim was to secure oil supplies for Germany and stabilize a nascent pro-German Democratic Republic of Georgia. The new republic brought the Ottoman Empire and Germany into conflict, with exchanges of official condemnations between them in the final months of the war. Recruitment. See also, conscription in the Ottoman Empire. Ottoman military recruitment near Tiberias. The Ottoman Empire established a new recruitment law on 12 May 1914. This lowered the conscription age from 20 to 18, and abolished the redif or reserve system. Active duty lengths were set at 2 years for the infantry, 3 years for other branches of the army, and 5 years for the navy. These measures remained largely theoretical during the war. Traditional Ottoman forces depended on volunteers from the Muslim population of the empire. Additionally, several groups and individuals in the Ottoman society volunteered for active duty during the World War, the major examples being the Mevlevi and the Kadiri. There were also units formed by Caucasian and Rumelian Turks, who took part in the battles in Mesopotamia and Palestine among Ottoman forces. Volunteers were not only from Turkic groups, there were also smaller numbers of Arab and Bedouin volunteers who fought in the campaign against the British to capture the Suez Canal, and in Mesopotamia volunteers were considered unreliable by the organized army, due to a lack of training and a perception of mainly mercenary interests. From the Arab and Bedouin volunteers, heavy fighting also placed pressure on the Ottoman volunteer system. Entente nations. Australian soldiers in Baghdad, 1917. Before the war, Russia had the Russian Caucasus Army, but almost half of this was redeployed to the Prussian front after the defeats at the battles of Tannenberg and the Masurian Lakes. Leaving behind just 60,000 troops in this theater in the summer of 1914, Armenian volunteer units were established under the Russian armed forces. Nearly 20,000 Armenian volunteers expressed their readiness to take up arms against the Ottoman Empire as early as 1914. These volunteer units increased in size during the war, to the extent that Bago Nubar, in a public letter to the Paris Peace Conference in 1919, stated that they numbered 150,000. The Assyrian people of southeast Anatolia, northern Mesopotamia, and northwestern Persia also threw in their lot with the Russians and British. Under the leadership of Aga Petros and Malik Koshaba in 1914, there were some British Indian Army units located in the southern parts of Persia. These units had extensive experience in dealing with dissident tribal forces. The British later established the Mediterranean Expeditionary Force, British Dardanelles Army, Egyptian Expeditionary Force, and in 1917 they established Dunster Force under Lionel Dunsterville, consisting of less than 1,000 Australian, British, Canadian and New Zealand troops accompanied by armoured cars to oppose Ottoman and German forces in the Caucasus in 1916. An Arab revolt began in the Hejaz. About 5,000 regular soldiers, mostly former prisoners of war of Arab origin, served with the forces of the revolt. There were also many irregular tribesmen under the direction of the Emir Faisal and British advisors of the advisors. Tay Lawrence is the best known. British troops on the march in Mesopotamia, 1917. France sent the French Armenian Legion to this theatre as part of its larger French Foreign Legion. Foreign Minister Aristide Briand needed to provide troops for French commitment made in the Sykes-Picot Agreement, which was still secret. Bago Nubar, the leader of the Armenian National Assembly, met with Sir Mark Sykes and Georges Picot. General Edmund Allenby, the commander of the Egyptian Expeditionary Force, extended the original agreement. The Armenian Legion fought in Palestine and Syria. Many of its volunteers were later released from the Legion to join their respective national armies. The Armenian National Liberation Movement commanded the Armenian Fedayi. Armenian Fedayi during these conflicts. These were generally referred to as Armenian militia. In 1917, the Dashniks established an Armenian corps under the command of General Tavmas Nazarbekian, which, with the declaration of the First Republic of Armenia, became the military corps of this new Armenian state. Nazarbekian became the first commander-in-chief. Recruitment. A group of Armenians responding to Russian recruitment for the Armenian volunteer units. Before the war, Russia established a volunteer system to be used in the Caucasus campaign in the summer of 1914. Armenian volunteer units led by Andranik Ozanian were established under the Russian armed forces, as the Russian Armenian conscripts had already been sent to the European front. This force was uniquely established from Armenians that were neither Russian subjects nor obliged to serve. The Armenian units were credited with no small measure of the success gained by the Russian forces, as they were natives of the region, adjusted to the climatic conditions, familiar with every road and mountain path, and had real incentives to fight. The Armenian volunteers were small, mobile, and well adapted to the semi-guerrilla warfare. They did good work as scouts, but also took part in numerous pitched battles. In December 1914, Nicholas II II of Russia visited the Caucasus campaign addressing the head of the Armenian Church, and Alexander Kadasyan, president of the Armenian National Bureau in Tiflis. He said, "From all countries Armenians are hurrying to enter the ranks of the glorious Russian army, with their blood to serve the victory of the Russian army. Let the Russian flag wave freely over the Dardanelles and the Bosporus. Let the peoples remaining under the Turkish yoke receive freedom. Let the Armenian people of Turkey who have suffered for the faith of Christ receive resurrection for a new free life." Nicholas II of Russia asymmetrical forces. The forces used in the Middle Eastern theater were not only regular army units which engaged in conventional warfare, but also irregular forces engaging in what is known today as asymmetrical conflict. Contrary to myth, it was not T.E. Lawrence or the British Army that conceptualized a campaign of internal insurgency against the Ottoman Empire in the Middle East. It was the Arab Bureau of Britain's Foreign Office that devised the Arab Revolt. The Arab Bureau had long felt it likely that a campaign instigated and financed by outside powers, supporting the breakaway-minded tribes and regional challengers to the Ottoman government's centralized rule of their empire, would pay great dividends in the diversion of effort that would be needed to meet such a challenge. The Ottoman authorities devoted far more resources to contain the threat of such an internal rebellion than the Allies devoted to sponsoring it. Germany established its own intelligence bureau for the East just before the outbreak of war. It was dedicated to promoting and sustaining subversive and nationalist agitations in the British Indian Empire, as well as in the Persian and Egyptian satellite states. Its operations in Persia, aimed at fomenting trouble for the British in the Persian Gulf, were led by Wilhelm Wasmus, a German diplomat who became known as the German Lawrence of Arabia or Wasmus of Persia. Chronology. Prelude. The Ottoman Empire made a secret Ottoman-German alliance on 2 August 1914, followed by another treaty with Bulgaria. The Ottoman War Ministry developed two major plans. Bronsert von Schellendorf, a member of the German military mission to the Ottoman Empire who had been appointed assistant chief of the Ottoman General Staff, completed a plan on 6 September 1914 by which the Fourth Army was to attack Egypt and the Third Army would launch an offensive against the Russians in eastern Anatolia. There was opposition to Schellendorf among the Ottoman army. The most voiced opinion was that Schellendorf planned a war which benefited Germany, rather than taking into account the conditions of the Ottoman Empire. Hafiz Haki Pasha presented an alternative plan, which was more aggressive, and concentrated on Russia. It was based on moving forces by sea to the eastern Black Sea coast, where they would develop an offensive against Russian territory. Hafiz Haki Pasha's plan was shelved because the Ottoman army lacked the resources. Schellendorf's primary campaign plan was therefore adopted by default as a result of Schellendorf's plan. Most of the Ottoman operations were fought in Ottoman territory, with the result that in many cases they directly affected the empire's own people. The later view was that the resources to implement this plan were also lacking, but Schellendorf organized the command and control of the army better, and positioned the army to execute the plans. Schellendorf also produced a better mobilization plan for raising forces and preparing them for war. The Ottoman War Ministry's archives contain war plans drafted by Schellendorf, dated 7 October 1914, which include details regarding Ottoman support to the Bulgarian army, a secret operation against Romania, and Ottoman soldiers landing in Odessa and Crimea with the support of the German Navy. Such was the German influence on Turkey's operations during the Palestine campaign that most of the staff posts in the Yildirim Army Group were held by German officers. Even the headquarters correspondence was produced in German. This situation ended with the final defeat in Palestine and the appointment of Mustafa Kemal to command the remnants of the Yildirim Army Group. During July 1914 there were negotiations between the Committee of Union and Progress Cup and Ottoman Armenians at the Armenian Congress at Erzurum. The public conclusion of the Congress was ostensibly conducted to peacefully advance Armenian demands by legitimate means. Erickson claims that the CUP regarded the Congress as a cause of Armenian insurrection, clarification needed, and that after this meeting, the CUP was convinced of the existence of strong Armenian-Russian links, with detailed plans to detach the region from the Ottoman Empire on 29 October 1914. The Ottoman Empire's first armed engagement with the Allies occurred when the German battlecruiser SMS command of the Ottoman Minister of the Marine, D. Jamal Pasha, to take the Suez Canal. The attack on Suez was suggested by War Minister Enver Pasha at the urging of their German ally. The Chief of Staff for the Ottoman Fourth Army was the Bavarian Colonel Kress von Kressenstein, who organized the attack and arranged supplies for the army as it crossed the desert. Citation needed. On 1 November, the Bergman Offensive was the first armed conflict of the Caucasus Campaign. The Russians crossed the frontier first, and planned to capture Dagubiazid and Koprakoy on their right wing. The Russian First Corps moved from Sarikamish toward Koprakoy on the left wing. The Russian Fourth Corps moved from Yerevan to the Pasinlar Plains. The commander of the Ottoman Third Army, Hasan Izzet, was not in favor of an offensive in the harsh winter conditions, but his plan to remain on the defensive and to launch a counterattack at the right time was overridden by the war minister Enver Pasha on 6 November. A British naval force bombarded the old fort at FAO. The FAO landing of British Indian Expeditionary Force DIEFD, consisting of the 6th Pune Division led by Lieutenant General Arthur Barrett, with Sir Percy Cox as political officer, was opposed by 350 Ottoman troops and 4 cannons on 22 November. The British occupied the city of Basra against a force of 2,900 Arab conscripts of the Iraq Area Command commanded by Sufi Pasha. Sufi Pasha and 1,200 men were captured. The main Ottoman army, under the overall command of Khalil Pasha, was located about 440 kilometers 270. November 1914. Ottoman forces preparation for the attack on the Suez Canal. 1914 personnel from the Armenian Volunteers, including Kecho, DRO, and Armin Garo. 1914 December. In December, at the height of the Battle of Sarikamish, General Myshlaevsky ordered the withdrawal of Russian forces from the Persian campaign to face Enver's offensive. Only one brigade of Russian troops under the command of the Armenian General Nazarbekov and one battalion of Armenian Volunteers remained scattered throughout Salmast and Urmia, while the main body of Ottoman troops were preparing for the operation in Persia. A small Russian group crossed the Persian frontier after repulsing a Russian offensive toward Van Persia mountain crossings. The Van Gendarmerie Division, a lightly equipped paramilitary formation commanded by Major Farid, chased the Russians into Persia on 14 December. The Van Gendarmerie Division occupied the city of Khodar in the Persian campaign later. It proceeded towards Khoi. It was supposed to keep this passage open for Kazim Bey's 5th Expeditionary Force and Halil Bey's 1st Expeditionary Force, who were to move towards Tabriz from the bridgehead established at Khodar. However, the Battle of Sarikamish depleted the Ottoman forces and these expeditionary forces were needed elsewhere. On 29 December, the Ottoman Third Army received the order to advance towards Kars Enver. Pasha assumed personal command of the Third Army and ordered his forces to move against the Russian troops, beginning the Battle of Sarikamish in the face of the Third Army's advance. Governor Vaontsov planned to pull the Russian Caucasus Army back to Kars. General Nikolai Yudinik ignored Vaontsov's order. December 1914. Zorovar Andranik's 1st Battalion of Armenians were scattered throughout the Salmast and Urmia districts in the early parts of the Persian campaign. December 1914. The initial British offensive during the Mesopotamian campaign. 1914-1915. January to March. Kurdish cavalry, employed by the Ottomans against the Russians in the passes of the Caucasus. January 1915. On 2 January, Suleyman Askeri Bey assumed the Iraq Area Command. Enver Pasha realized the mistake of underestimating the importance of the Mesopotamian campaign. The Ottoman army did not have any other resources to move to this region, as an attack on Gallipoli was imminent. Suleyman Askeri Bey sent letters to Arab sheikhs in an attempt to organize them to fight against the British on 3 January. At the Battle of Kurna, Ottoman forces tried to retake the city of Basra. They came under fire from Royal Navy vessels on the River Euphrates, while British troops managed to cross the River Tigris. Judging that Basra's earthworks were too strong to be taken, the Ottomans surrendered the town of Al-Kurna and retreated to Kut on 6 January. The Third Army headquarters found itself under fire. Hafiz Haki Pasha ordered a total retreat at the Battle of Sarikamish. Only 10% of the army managed to retreat to its starting position. Enver gave up command of the army during this conflict. Armenian detachments challenged the Ottoman operations at the critical times. The delay enabled the Russian Caucasus Army to concentrate sufficient force around Sarikamish. The British and France asked Russia to relieve the pressure on Western Front, but Russia needed time to organize its forces. The operations in the Black Sea gave them the chance to replenish their forces. Also, the Gallipoli campaign drew many Ottoman forces from the Russian and other fronts. In March 1915, the Ottoman Third Army received reinforcements amounting to a division from the 1st and 2nd Armies. On the 19th of February, a strong Anglo-French fleet, including the British battleship HMS to target the narrowest point of the Dardanelles where the straits are just a mile wide. The French battleship Bouvet exploded in mysterious circumstances, causing it to capsize with its entire crew aboard. Minesweepers, manned by civilians and under constant fire from Ottoman guns, retreated, leaving the minefields largely intact. The battleship HMS Campaign, January 1915 6th, Army Field HQ during the Mesopotamian Campaign, 1915 the Camel Corps at Beersheba during the Sinai and Palestine Campaign, February 1915 the Bouvet during the Gallipoli Campaign, March 1915 April to June following their unexpected success in the Mesopotamia Campaign, the British command decided on more aggressive operations in April 1915, General Sir John Nixon was sent to take command. He ordered Major General Charles Vere Furrers Townsend to advance to Kut or even to Baghdad if possible. Enver Pasha worried about the possible fall of Baghdad, and sent the German general Kolmar Freiherr von der Goltz to take command on 12 April. Suleiman Askari attacked the British camp at Sheba with 3,800 troops early in the morning. These forces, mainly provided by Arab sheikhs, achieved nothing. Suleiman Askari was wounded, disappointed and depressed. He shot himself at the hospital in Baghdad on 20 April. The siege of Van began on 24 April, Talat Pasha promulgated the order on April 24 known by the Armenians as the Red Sunday, which stated that the Armenians in this region were led by Russians and had rebelled against Ottoman government. The Allies began their amphibious assault on the Gallipoli Peninsula on the European side of the Dardanelles. The following day the troops were able to land, but could not dislodge the Ottoman forces even after months of battle that caused the deaths of an estimated 131,000 soldiers, and 262,000 wounded. Eventually they withdrew. The campaign represented something of a coming of age for Australia and New Zealand, who celebrate 25 April as Anzac Day. Kemal Ataturk, who later became the first leader of modern Turkey, distinguished himself as a lieutenant colonel at Gallipoli on 6 May. General Yudenik began an offensive into Ottoman territory. One wing of this offensive headed towards Lake Van to relieve its Armenian defenders. The Fedayi turned over the city to the Russians on 21 May. General Yudenik received the keys to the city and its citadel, and confirmed the Armenian provisional government in office with Aram Manukyan as governor with Van secure. Fighting shifted farther west for the rest of the summer. On 6 May, the Russian 2nd Wing advanced through the Tordum Valley towards Erzurum after the weather turned milder. The Ottoman 29th and 30th Divisions managed to stop this assault. The 10th Corps counter-attacked the Russian forces on the southern front. The Ottomans were not as successful as they had been in the north. The city of Manzikert had already fallen on the 11th of May. The Ottomans' supply lines were being cut, as the Armenian forces caused additional difficulties behind the lines. The region south of Lake Van was extremely vulnerable during May. The Ottomans had to defend a line of more than 600 kilometers 370. Outnumbered by the Russians on 27 May, during the high point of the Russian offensive, the Ottoman parliament passed the Tesser Law. Talat Pasha, the interior minister, ordered a forced deportation of all Armenians from the regions under Ottoman control on 19 June. The Russians launched another offensive northwest of Lake Van commanded by Oganovsky. They advanced into the hills west of Malazgirt, but had underestimated the size of the Ottoman forces. They were surprised by a large Ottoman force at the Battle of Manzikert. They were not aware that the Ottoman 9th Corps, together with the 17th and 28th Divisions, was moving to Mush. Also the 1st and 5th Expeditionary Forces were positioned to the south of the Russian offensive force, and a right-wing group was established under the command of Brigadier General Abdulkarim Pasha. This group was independent from the 3rd Army, and Abdulkarim Pasha was reporting directly to Enver Pasha. April to June 1915 Armenian troops holding a defense line at the Siege of Van, April 1915 Armenian resistance members from the Adapazari Committee, 1915 July to September. On 24 September, General Yudenik became the supreme commander of all Russian forces in the region. This front was quiet from October until the end of the year. Yudenik used this period to reorganize. By 1916, Russian forces in the theater had grown to 200,000 men and 380 pieces of artillery. On the other side, the situation was very different. The Ottoman High Command failed to make up the losses during this period. The war in Gallipoli was using up all available resources and manpower. The IX, 10th and 11th Corps could not be reinforced, and the 1st and 5th Expeditionary Forces were deployed to Mesopotamia. Enver Pasha, after failing to achieve his ambitions in the Caucasus, and possibly recognizing the dire situation on other fronts, decided that the Caucasus front was of secondary importance. July to September 1915 Mustafa Kemal at Gallipoli with his soldiers, 1915 a trench at Lone Pine after the battle, showing Australian and Turkish dead on the parapet, 1915 October to December the rapid advance of the British up the river changed some of the Arab tribes' perception of the conflict. Realizing that the British had the upper hand, many of them joined the British efforts. They raided Ottoman military hospitals and massacred the soldiers in Amara. On 22 November, Townsend and von der Goltz fought the battle at Cte Siphon. The battle was inconclusive, as both the Ottomans and the British retreated from the battlefield. Townsend halted and fortified the position at Kut al-Amara. His forces were surrounded there, and on 7 December the siege of Kut began. Von der Goltz helped the Ottoman forces build defensive positions around Kut, and established new fortified positions downriver to fend off any attempt to rescue Townsend. General Aylmer made three attempts to break the siege, but each effort was unsuccessful. Townsend surrendered his entire force on 29 April 1916. In December, the British government continued their attempts to cultivate favour with Ibn Saud via its secret agent, Captain William Shakespeare, but this was abandoned after Shakespeare's death at the Battle of Jarab. Instead, the British transferred support to Ibn Saud's rival Sharif Hussein bin Ali, leader of the Hejaz, with whom the Saudis were almost constantly at war. Lord Kitchener also appealed to Hussein bin Ali, Sharif of Mecca, for assistance in the conflict. Hussein wanted political recognition in return. An exchange of letters with Henry McMahon assured him that his assistance would be rewarded after the war by granting him control of the territory between Egypt and Persia, with the exception of imperial possessions and interests in Kuwait, Aden, and the Syrian coast. Britain entered into the Treaty of Dayran, which made the lands of the House of Saud a British protectorate. Ibn Saud pledged to again make war against Ibn Rashid, who was an ally of the Ottomans, and in exchange was given a monthly stipend. October to December 1915, defenders of the Urfa resistance. July 1915, the trenches during the siege of Kut. December 1915-1916, the Turkish general staff of the Mesopotamian campaign. 1916 in 1916, a combination of diplomacy and genuine dislike of the new leaders of the Ottoman Empire. The three pashas convinced Sharif Hussein bin Ali of Mecca to begin a revolt. He gave the leadership of this revolt to two of his sons, Faisal and Abdullah, though the planning and direction for the war was largely the work of Lawrence of Arabia. The Russian offensive in northeastern Turkey started with a victory at the Battle of Koprakoy and culminated with the capture of Erzurum in February and Trabzon in April. By the Battle of Erzincan, the Ottoman Third Army was no longer capable of launching an offensive, nor could it stop the advance of the Russian army. The Ottoman forces launched a second attack across the Sinai with the objective of destroying or capturing the Suez Canal. Both this and the earlier attack 1915 were unsuccessful, though not very costly by the standards of the Great War. The British then went on the offensive, attacking east into Palestine. However, two failed attempts to capture the Ottoman fort of Gaza resulted in sweeping changes to the British command and the arrival of General Allenby, along with many reinforcements. 1917 British artillery during the Battle of Jerusalem. 1917 British Empire forces reorganized and captured Baghdad in March 1917. On 16 December, the Armistice of Erzincan. Erzincan ceasefire agreement was signed, which officially brought the end of hostilities between the Ottoman Empire and the Russians. The Special Transcaucasian Committee also endorsed the agreement. The Sinai and Palestine campaign was dominated by the success of the revolt, which greatly aided General Allenby's operations. Late in 1917, Allenby's Egyptian Expeditionary Force smashed the Ottoman defenses and captured Gaza, and then captured Jerusalem just before Christmas. While strategically of lesser importance to the war, this event was key in the subsequent creation of Israel as a separate nation in 1948-1918. Ottoman trenches along the shores of the Dead Sea. 1918 The war-weary Ottoman Empire could be quickly defeated with campaigns in Palestine and Mesopotamia, but the German spring offensive in France delayed the expected Allied attack. General Allenby was given brand new divisions recruited from India. The British achieved complete control of the air. General Lehman von Sanders had no clear idea where the British were going to attack, compounding the problems. The Ottomans withdrew their best troops to serve in the Caucasus campaign. General Allenby finally launched the Battle of Megiddo, with the Jewish Legion under his command. Ottoman troops started a full-scale retreat. T.E. Lawrence and his Arab fighters staged many hit-and-run attacks on supply lines and tied down thousands of soldiers in garrisons throughout Palestine, Jordan, and Syria. On 3 March, the Grand Vizier Talat Pasha signed the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk with the Russian SFSR, which stipulated that Bolshevik Russia cede Batum, Kars, and Ardahan to the Ottoman Empire. The Trabzon Peace Conference was held between March and April between the Ottoman Empire and the delegation of the Transcaucasian Diet. Transcaucasian Sejm and government. The Treaty of Brest-Litovsk united the Armenian and Georgian territories. The First Republic of Armenia declared war on the Ottoman Empire in early May 1918. The Ottoman army faced the Armenian Corps of Armenia Armenian National Councils, which soon declared the First Republic of Armenia. The Ottoman army captured Trabzon, Erzurum, Kars, Van, and Batum. The conflict led to the Battle of Sardarapat, the Battle of Kara Kilis 1918, and the Battle of Bash Abaran, although the Armenians managed to inflict a defeat on the Ottomans at the Battle of Sardarapat. The Ottoman army won the later battle and scattered the Armenian army. The fight with First Republic of Armenia ended with the Treaty of Batum in June 1918. Throughout the summer of 1918, under the leadership of Andranik Ozanian, Armenians in the mountainous Karabag region resisted the Ottoman Third Army and established the Republic of Mountainous Armenia. The Army of Islam avoided Georgia and marched to the Azerbaijan Democratic Republic. They got as far as Baku on the Caspian Sea. They threw the British out in September 1918 at the Battle of Baku. Aftermath: on the 30th of October 1918, the Armistice of Mudros was signed on aboard the HMS of Istanbul, along with the occupation of Izmir, contributed to the establishment of the Turkish National Movement and led to the Turkish War of Independence Peace Treaty. See also, partitioning of the Ottoman Empire on 18 January 1919, peace negotiations began with the Paris Peace Conference. The negotiations continued at the Conference of London, but the treaty took definite shape only after the Premier's meeting at the San Remo Conference in April 1920. France, Italy, and Great Britain had been secretly planning the partition of the Ottoman Empire as early as 1915. The Ottoman government representatives signed the Treaty of Sèvres on 10 August 1920, but the treaty was not sent to the Ottoman parliament for ratification, as the parliament had been abolished on 18 March 1920 by the British. As a result, the treaty was never ratified by the Ottoman Empire. The Treaty of Sèvres was annulled in the course of the Turkish War of Independence, and the parties signed and ratified the superseding Treaty of Lausanne in 1923. Abolition of the Caliphate. On 3 March 1924, the Ottoman Caliphate was abolished when Mustafa Kemal Atatürk deposed the last caliph, Abdul Mejid. Two casualties.